Hey everybody, Ivan Novik here from the Green Plum team at VMware. And today I'm gonna do a single node edition Green Plum installation. So it's super easy. If you want to install Green Plum and you have a VM, it can be, or a physical machine, but if you're assuming you have a virtual machine, whether that machine is in Amazon, Azure, Google, vSphere, VirtualBox on your local system, any system where you have a VM, let's go ahead and install single node edition Green Plum on it. Now, for this one, I did one step after installing a CentOS 7 VM. So I did a standard CentOS 7 install. Let's just have a look at that. And you can see it's CentOS 7.9, which is one of our OSs. It's a, you know, a very widely used operating system for Green Plum, but there's a variety of OSs you can pick from. And then the only thing I did was I edited SE Linux configuration to disable it and reboot it, so you didn't have to sit there waiting for my VM to reboot. Other than that, nothing has changed. This is a pure fresh operating system install, and we're going to take you through the full process end to end to just bring up a Green Plum system. So in order for me to be comfortable, I will install Vim, and I'll also install wget, which is going to help me to get the software downloaded to our system. And then we will go ahead. I'm going to actually give you a quick tour of the hardware that we have here. So this is let's see how many cores I've created in this environment. This is an 8 virtual processor system. And as far as memory, this is a 16 gig VM. So this is just for testing. Now, we're gonna go ahead and configure the operating system. Now, please look at the link in the description. We have a fully documented process of configuring the operating system. Now for production, there's about 10 different settings you need to set. They could be set through any automated OS deployment mechanism or templating system that you may be comfortable with. I'm gonna set the 3, 4, or 5 configuration settings that I know I need to do this demo, just the minimum configuration. So let's set up the systemctl, which is one of the key files for configuration. And I'm going to copy and paste from my cheat sheet here, and you will see it appear. So the overcommit memory is critical. That tells Linux that we know what we're doing with the database. Do not overcommit the memory. Let's just use the memory we said we're going to use, and we'll use a ratio of 95. And then let's also carve out some ports below 10,000 that'll be reserved for the database. So the system can feel free to use 10,000 to 65,000 for whatever it wants to, but below 10,000, let's use those only as reserve ports. And then let's bump up the default number of semaphores. Postgres and Green Plum do use semaphores, and I don't want to hit into a ceiling there doing the demo. So we'll save that and we will reload it to go into effect. And then the other thing is the security limits. So by default, the system has fairly low limits in a CentOS install in terms of number of files and number of processes. So we want to raise those, you know, let us create as many files and processes as we want up to these number, right? So we can create lots of files and lots of processes in our software. Okay, that's it. That's the OS configuration. It took me about 1 or 2 minutes talking through, but you should templatize it and add all the production settings that you're going to want, any customizations, any institutional enterprise standards that you have, plus reading the best practices that we have online in the links in the video. Let us create a user and a group for GP admin and add the user to that group. We will run the software in that user environment. And after that, I will go and download the software. So you can download it with wget. I did it pretty fast, but I'm downloading from GitHub, the open source distribution under releases. You can browse to that and see the latest version. I'm using 6.21, it's a solid version. And then we will use the yum command to install this RPM, not the RPM command, the yum command, because the yum command will also bring the dependencies that are triggered from the RPM. So that installs the software, we are good to go. Now, the software has to be put into our path. The way this works is that a directory is created with the software, a symlink is created, so that allows you to easily switch between versions of the software. So if I go to user, local, you can see here is the link, GreenFlameDB, and the software 21. And in there, you can see there is a path file, greenflamepath.sh. This has everything in it that we need to make the software in our environment. So I will go into the bash rc of our gp admin user, and I will add a source command to source the path file, which will set up the environment. So anytime we log into gp admin, this will be sourced. We will have the gp home environment and all the software, right, will be installed. We are good to go. Okay. GreenFlame is a clustered system. It assumes that it's running on multiple hosts with different host names. So we need to set up a host file. And we only have one host because this is a single node demo. But you have to put each host, like ABC host, DEF host, whatever your host names are, into the file. We have one host, and that host file will be used as input to various utilities that we can use to set up the system. It's really only used at setup time. After the system's set up, it's actually stored in the database, all the hosts and Postgres segments that are part of the system. So we will create a SSH key, and we will push that key around the cluster so that we can use SSH to move around. That being set up, we now have the, one more thing for the environment. We need a place to store the data. So we have here a data directory. Actually, everything is under root. So I'm just going to create a data directory right here. And we'll use that directory to place all our Postgres segments. All right. We are ready to initialize the GreenFlame cluster. Instead of doing it from scratch, I am going to copy the configuration file from a template that comes deployed in the software. If you go into gpconfigs, there's a bunch of stuff here. In particular, the gpinit system single node template, I'm gonna copy to the home directory and let's edit it. The array name is fine. That's not really used for anything. The machine list file, we created a file, but it was just called hosts. The segment prefix, this is the data directory, the segment directories that created each of the Postgres instances will have a prefix name, so you can see a pattern that will be indicated here. You can customize that. The port base, you can customize that. All right, now we're going to create one host. We have one host. And this variable tells you on each host, how many segments to create. So if I had 100 hosts and I created four directories here, that would create a total of 400 Postgres segments in my cluster. Now, that's critical because that tells you the level of parallelism and sharding in the Greenplum systems. This is a very key line in the configuration. We have one host, so this configuration here would create two Postgres segments. It's a little bit boring. I think we should create three Postgres segments to show the demo. And that directory is not valid. That's just a template. So we created a directory home gpadmin data, and we can go ahead and just use that directory for all of our segments. You can make multiple names here and they could go into different locations, each, or you can have them be the same. For convenience, we'll just do it all in one directory. Master host name, that's gonna be GP host. In this case, that's the name of this VM. And the master data directory will be exactly in the same location as the workers. We just have one directory, although you can configure that. And we are good to go. There's nothing else here we need to do. So we have a configuration file. We have directories set up. We have the software installed. We have the OS configured. The only thing left for us to do is to initialize the cluster. GPInit system reads that file and goes and creates the cluster, all of the Postgres segments, links them up, creates the catalog, initializes the catalog, and gives you a working environment. So let us to do this, except I've made an error. We have created the host file called host file. I told you it was called hosts. Fine. Let us update that. It was called host file. And then we are good to go. This doesn't take a bit and it's ready. It's configuring three worker nodes. Now you see here the directory. They're all in the data directory. You can customize that in the file. This is the prefix we saw, GP single node edition. And then these are the content IDs. We have three worker nodes. So the content IDs are labeled sequentially 0, 1, and 2. And the content of the master or the coordinator is -1. That's shown up above somewhere else. So we'll go ahead and create that. So this is going out and actually doing the initialization of all the different Postgres database instances and linking them together. And if you had 100 nodes, this would be in parallel. So it'd be doing it in parallel, not sequentially one by one. It has pretty much finished. Now there is one post install step that I highly recommend, which I'm gonna add one more variable to the configuration file. So if you see here our data directory, we have created three worker segments and one master segment. The master segment is always -1. So we're gonna grab that location and some of the Greenplum utilities leverage a environment variable that I'm gonna set. Master data directory equals. All right. So we should have now our system. This PSQL is the command line tool, right? This lists the databases. It comes pre-installed with two templates plus the Postgres DB. The templates are for, really don't mess with the templates. It's a advanced technique. We could talk about another video. The Postgres database is used for DBA. So you don't want to log into your real database. You can log into the Postgres database and do DBA type monitoring commands and whatnot. Let's create a new database called TestDB and let's log into that one. From here, you can do something like select star from GP segment configuration. This is the key table that explains the metadata for your cluster. So this is ties everything together. This shows you the worker nodes, the master node, all that. All right, cluster is up. let us to do a little SQL and show that it's working. Let's create a table. We will generate the numbers from 1 to 1,000,000 and put them into the table one per row. So that's what we've done here. We called it create table as a select with a function, generate 1,000,000 rows, distribute this table by that only column that we have, column A. It created the 1,000,000 rows. We can easily now validate, count them, or do something like a sum on the data. And it's super fast on just a single node. Now imagine you had real hardware or big hardware or lots of hardware. It's all parallel, right? But it's gonna be super fast. Now, we're pretty much done deploying single node addition. For the full life cycle of the process, I'll also show you how to clean up your environment. So let's do a GPA delete system that basically uses the master data directory, identifies the cluster, and says, are you sure you want to delete it? Don't do this in production. Do this when you really want to delete it. And that will clean up our environment. And I hope that this demo has showed you how easy it is to get a VM, configure it, install the software, initialize a cluster, and be up and running in a second. It's only, all you need is Linux machines. The system will run as fast as the hardware you give it. Greenplum will push to the limit, and that's how you do it. So until the next video, thanks a lot and take care.